We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills.
There's only a very few men that walked on the moon. And so, in some people's eyes, they're rock stars. I mean, they're unique. They were definitely America's heroes, and still are, I think, in my mind. We got used to them being the men we worked for and not America's heroes, you know, because we saw them every day. And so they just became the people that we supported, and they were just the guys. You know, we had the civil rights movement in the late 60s, and so there was still a lot of that going on, and then also the Vietnam War. It was juxtaposed by the feeling of achievement through the Apollo program. It was like the space program was needed to balance the difficult things that our country was going through. When I showed up at the astronaut office, and I didn't realize I was in the astronaut office until the second day I was there. I mean, I was told, here's my desk, here's what you're going to do. They hand me a pile of mail, started opening up mail. I didn't even know I was really answering astronaut mail.
This is Houston, say again, please.
Yes, Houston, we've had a problem. We've had a main B bus undervolt.
Roger, main B undervolt. Okay, stand by.
Apollo 13 had happened that year in April. That tugged at not only, you know, the heartstrings of the American public, but all over the world. The Apollo 13 astronauts were heroes, and so the people wanted to reach out to them. It was the last moon mission. My memory is being on the roof of the building where they were quarantined. And we ran up to the roof and waited for the launch. And when they say the Earth shook, the Earth shook. It was just spectacular. The whole night sky lit up, and it's a memory I will never, never forget. Women in the workplace were primarily women like me. They were in secretarial roles, administrative roles. There were very, very few technical women. That's when they started the discussion about, you know, women in space, and, you know, the Russians had already put a woman in space, and so it was time that we did. My boss was George Abbey. He was the director of flight operations, and he was very instrumental in bringing that conversation to the forefront about needing women in space. And I met Sally Ride. She was my age when she was selected, and that was a defining moment for me. And I was already thinking about going to college. That, it was like, wow, she's my age, but she's a PhD. Why not me? It just struck me that that was a moment I could do something and change the course of my career. So I went to school. I went to college and got my degree at the University of Houston, and then later got my master's. I truly believe it was just the culture at the time in the 60s. People were used to seeing males in predominantly science and engineering roles. And you see a culture change, you see a shift. And women are now being graduated with master's degrees and PhDs like Sally Ride. And you're thinking, okay, why not them? You know, and Judy Resnick with a PhD in electrical engineering, you know, and so, why not them in those positions? And so finally the tide was turning, you know, in the late 70s and then definitely in the early 80s. You know, for me, it's hard to believe that that was me, that I was honored and privileged to be at that particular time in history and to make a mark, a small mark in space history. There weren't too many things we were awfully proud of during that time period, but the space program was one of them. And I think that's what people needed to see, was pride in our country and in our achievements and what we could do. And when I looked in the faces and saw everyone around me, it was hard not to be a part of that, not to realize how special a moment that was.